All right, everyone, welcome. We are, people are starting to come in to the session. We'll get started in just a moment. All right, well, welcome everyone to our next edition of our AEPiConnect webinar speaker series. This program today is a part of our Leven leadership series in which we host AEPi alumni and guests to discuss a variety of topics and subjects. And today we have a real treat. But before I get started, I also wanna say Chag Shavuot Sameach. Happy Shavuot to our brothers and our families and friends out there. Interestingly enough, when we first scheduled this session and went over the dates, it became a reminder that Shavuot is one of the holidays that's only celebrated for one day in Israel, and our guests are tuning in from Israel. And so we're gonna be recording today's session so that it can be available for others to view going forward, and will be available on AEPi's YouTube channel. And so without further ado, we'll get started with, as I said, a very special session today. It's my pleasure to introduce our moderator for today's program, Alex Zand, who is our Leadership Development Associate at the AEPi Foundation. And he will introduce our guests and we'll get going. So please, Alex, go ahead.
Oh, well, thank you, Jay. Hello, brothers and friends. My name is Alex Zand, and I am a member of the AEPi Foundation team. I want to welcome you all to our monthly AEPiConnect webinar series featuring both brothers Rudy Rockman and Noam Liebman. Before we begin, I just want to let everyone know that I put in the chat, if you guys have any questions throughout our program today, please feel free to submit those in the Q&A at the bottom, and we will try and get all of your questions asked throughout the program. So let me introduce our featured guest today. Rudy Rockman is an AEPi brother from UCLA before transferring to Columbia. He was born in France and grew up moving around the world from Paris, Miami, LA, Palo Alto, Israel, New York, and Singapore. At age 17, he voluntarily enlisted in the IDF paratroopers and served as a sniper in the 101st Airborne Brigade, which he still serves as a reservist today. Noam Liebman is also an AEPi brother from the University of Minnesota and is currently the owner of Kavanaugh Films and the filmmaker of We Were Never Lost documentary that they will be talking about a little bit later on. Rudy Rockman and Noam Liebman create educational viral content aimed at shifting the global ideological and political conversations regarding both the Jewish people and for Israel. The work primarily focuses on empowering Jews and our allies, uniting sectors of Israeli society, as well as generating innovative ways to combat anti-Semitism. I would like to now turn it over to both of them so that they can give us a brief introduction about their background. So Noam, if you'd like to go first, you have the floor.
All right, thank you, Alex. And thank you guys again for putting this on. So I grew up in Minnesota and I joined the AEPi chapter at University of Minnesota. I actually was not planning to join a fraternity, but once I met the guys there, I ended up getting very involved and I was the recruitment chair for my chapter. So I really wanted my chapter to be respected on campus, for Jews to be looked at and appreciated. So I put in a lot of work in my fraternity into growing, being involved in Greek life, and I really look back on that time of my life with fond memories. So after graduation, I moved out to New York City to pursue filmmaking, to grow my video production business, and look for opportunities out there. And I lived there for 3 years. And early on there, I met Rudy. I heard him speak for the first time. And he gave a presentation talking about activism for Israel. And he was using language and ideas that were completely new to me. Things like Judaism not being a religion, Jewish people being indigenous to the land of Israel. And these concepts really sparked an interest in me that made me want to see if Rudy and I might be able to create some content together. So after that first meeting, we started making a few little social media clips, expanding on these ideas. Slowly, we started touring around to different campuses where Rudy would engage with college students, and I'd be taking videos of the interactions that would ensue. And slowly but surely, over those past 4 years, we've grown this activism work into a much bigger project that we're going to be talking about today, which is We Were Never Lost. It's a documentary series throughout 6 countries in Africa, showing these disconnected, remote communities of Jews and letting them tell their stories. And through that process, telling the larger story of who the Jewish people are. So now I made Aliyah a year ago. I live in Tel Aviv, Israel. And basically right now I'm focused on learning Hebrew and working on We Were Never Lost.
Amazing. And Rudy?
So I was born in France, moved to Israel when I was 3, then to Miami when I was 5. Grew up most of my early childhood life in the US. Age of 17, I left Israel to join the army. When I finished the army, I started school at UCLA. That's where I pledged and joined AEPi. I was the pledge class president. Like Noam, I also didn't really want to join a fraternity. I was after the army, but there was a student there that told me that a lot of the Jews needed empowerment and a role model and that connection to Israel. And 2013 was also the time that they tried to pass the first BDS resolution at UCLA. And AEPi took a big role to make sure that it got shut down. So I realized that AEPi was not just a place for social life and friends, but also a place to make things happen for the cause that you believe in. After that, I spent a year in Asia doing a backpacking trip post-army, and I transferred to Columbia University, where I also transferred to the AEPi over there. While I was a student at Columbia, I met Noam, and all these videos began going viral. But there's also another passion that was sparked. While I was a student, I often would go to the Chabad house. And one day I'm sitting doing some work, and there's a woman who comes to visit Chabad Rabbi with this very unique looking kippah. And she gives it to him as a gift. And I asked her, you know, where did you get this from? It has menorahs, it has a Magen David, it's very interesting. And she says, oh, I just got back from Africa on our honeymoon trip, and we visited these Jewish communities. Look on my phone, they're in these remote areas and they're putting tefillin and speaking Hebrew. And when I saw that, I was shocked. How is it that I left at 17 to do the army? I've been passionate about Jewish people and Jewish history my whole life. I went to Columbia specifically because it was listed as the number one most anti-Semitic school that year that I transferred. And I don't even know about these Jewish communities in Africa. And I started to do research, and I'm like, hold on, we've been talking about this concept of quote unquote lost tribes our entire lives. We've all heard about it, whether historically or from the Torah. Even when we read the Amidah 3 times a day, it talks about bringing back and doing kibbutz galiot. In the Torah, it clearly says, in the times of Mashiach, the tribes of Israel reunite from the 4 corners of the earth. So this has been a concept that's been familiar to the Jewish people from a cultural, historical perspective to a biblical, religious perspective. And I asked myself, like, why have we never tried to go and find them or to reconnect with them? And that's when me and Noam decided to at first do these sort of social videos on these stories, but then that evolved to a documentary, which then evolved into a documentary series and set us to creating this huge project where season 1 is based in Africa, season 2 is based in Asia, season 3 is based in South America on these different disconnected communities of Jews. And it's called We Were Never Lost because in fact, their identity was always kept. They are actually not lost at all. It was the connection that we had with each other that was lost, which is why we titled it We Were Never Lost.
That's a great story. I want to ask you both, and I know Noam, you touched on it a little bit on how you both met. But in AEPi, many people often talk about the power of brotherhood and the power of connections among different chapters. And if you meet someone who's in AEPi, you feel this instant connection. So Rudy, if you want to tell us all how you guys connected and go off of what Noam said a little bit earlier. And then both of you, if you can explain the power of connections and what connections and networking means to you.
For sure. I mean, first of all, when you meet a fellow Jew and you hear that someone's a Jew, there's an automatic connection of being a family. And then on top of that, if you're an AEPi, it also represents that you have a similar experience and a similar core values and similar friend groups and similar objectives. So, you know, today, especially, I mean, maybe it was different 20 years ago, 30 years ago, but Jewish students on college campuses don't have such an easy time. There's a lot of anti-Semitism. There's a lot of things that we're dealing with. And AEPi is not just a social environment. It's also a place for Jews to unite and to be able to fight together for their own core people. So I feel like whenever you meet someone who's in AEPi, not only is there that prestige of the history of this fraternity, it's you're a fellow Jew, you're a fellow person who cares about their Jewish values. You're in the same fraternity, so you have very similar experiences as us. We know the same chants and songs. We played the same games in order to be a part of this fraternity. We've met at similar conferences. We all know Jay and Andy Borantz. So there's right away more than just a connection than you would have to just meeting a Jew, which in itself is a huge connection. So obviously when I met Noam, fellow Jew, cares about his people, was an AEPi, you add 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 together, right away, even without knowing the person, you can tell that you're probably going to get along.
Yeah, I completely agree with everything you said. Noam, do you have anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, I want to add that... basically, my interest in Israel only started towards the end of my college experience when I was wearing a t-shirt that said Israel on it, and there were some Arab students looking at me and giving me dirty looks and pointing and clearly talking about my shirt. And I kind of felt like if they were to come over and speak to me, I don't know if I would be able to hold a conversation and to be able to represent Israel. And if the Jewish people can't represent Israel, no one's going to do it for us. So that sent me on my own journey of wanting to learn more, to be able to speak and be educated about the history of the Middle East, the conflicts, you know, what's happening right now. But it's hard to educate yourself on such a massive topic. And so it was maybe a year after that where I met Rudy, and I felt like here's a guy who's my age, who's in AEPi, he's in college, and he's really taken it upon himself to become very educated in this field and be outspoken about it. So I was drawn to that. And since we've been creating content that's getting a lot of attention, I can see that other people have been drawn to it too and are seeking guidance in that space of being on campus and not knowing how to respond to people demonizing and attacking Israel.
Hey, you brought up a good point. It's definitely something that knowing how to have those conversations is a real asset. Now, one of our previous guests from last month, Elon Carr, says that one of the greatest challenges facing our Jewish community today is the Jewish people's own lack of Jewish history and knowing our Jewish story. Now, Rudy, I know that your activism, as Noam said earlier, initially started talking about Israel on college campuses, but now has developed to talking about the importance of Jews understanding their own history. For example, some people explain Judaism as a religion, an ethnicity, a culture, et cetera. So I want to know from you both that we know that we often speak about this topic, and you're one of those that speaks all around the world about this topic. So how would you explain what the Jewish people are?
For sure. First of all, I think that most of our content and the work that we do has five missions. First of all, any of the videos that we make, it's always about creating a social change. It's not just to make a video to get views. It's for that video to then have an impact on the world around. For example, a lot of the videos are debates, and we do that in order to give people a secondhand experience of what those situations actually look like, what people respond to, what people say, what they claim, how to remain calm, to give people the tools to not only be Jews in theory, but Jews in practice. So we're taught a lot in our Jewish education. Some had more of an education, some had less, but all of us had some sort of at least a little bit of an experience, whether you went to a synagogue one time or put tefillin from a Chabad rabbi or went to a Seder or went to even a Jewish day school your whole life. Whatever it is, we were taught to practice Judaism rather than putting Judaism into practice, meaning being Jews out in the world instead of just being Jews in our own safe space. So our five missions are very clear. Number one, fighting and combating anti-Semitism, making sure that this is something rejected by society and recognized and conditioned and something wrong. Number two, empowering the next generation of Jews for them to be able to narrate their own story and stand up for themselves. Number three, that there's no vision or mission statement for a people or collective or country. There's nothing that's moving us forward that we have an objective for. Number four, Israeli-Palestinian conflict. There's no future where Israelis or Palestinians disappear. And number five, the tribes of Israel being disconnected. I would say those are the five things that we really focus on our content. Now, how do we explain what a Jew is and who is a Jew? Well, first of all, why do we constantly say from our videos that Judaism is not a religion? We have to first define what a religion is to be able to say that Judaism is not. So a religion is a belief system in a God, deity, book, or prophet. So if an individual does not believe in the God, deity, book, or prophet, they're not a part of the religion. Hence, if someone's a Christian and doesn't believe in Jesus, they're not a Christian. If someone's a Muslim, comes from a Muslim family, does not believe in the Quran or Muhammad at some point in their life, they're no longer Muslim. Same thing with Buddhism, Hinduism, and every single other religion. So when it comes to Judaism, even if an individual doesn't believe in Hashem, which is a core part of our culture, they're still a Jew, because it's not a wandering ideology that crossed over borders and nations. It's a physical people that were forced to cross those borders and nations and preserve their identity through a portable suitcase that they called Judaism, that they passed down generation to generation with the aspiration of Shana Baba Yerushalayim. Also, in order for someone to become a Christian or Muslim or Buddhist or whatever it is, within a second of identifying with that philosophy or ideology, they are now considered a part of it. Whereas to become a Jew, you have to go through years of a process to adopt an identity, a history, a culture, a value system, traditions, the suffering that comes along with being a Jew, the purpose, the connection to a land, the language. You're joining an ancient civilization. So we can't see ourselves as Christians, because Christians, you can look at an Argentinian Christian, Nigerian Christian, and Chinese Christian, and these are three different peoples with the same ideology. And the moment that an individual does not believe in that anymore, they're now no longer Christians. Whereas a Jew, wherever we're living, we're actually the physical descendant of an ancient civilization. So I think the better way or examples to understand the Jewish people is as the Mayans, the Aztecs, the Maoris, Tibetans, Kurds, Coptics, ancient civilizations that still exist, and that passed down their tradition, and that achieved finally to create their aspirations of reviving their homeland in the land of Israel.
Beautifully said. Noam, do you have anything you'd like to add?
Oh, I think Rudy nailed that one. We can move on.
Well, then I'll ask this question to you first, but I want to hear both of you on this. So when promoting this program, we included an article provided detailed accounts of both of your experience in Nigeria. Can you first tell us the purpose of your trip to Africa a little bit more in depth? And I know that you guys already touched on your documentary, but tell us a little bit about your experience in Africa.
Mm-hmm. So each community of Jews in Africa has a very different story. Some of them are believed to be descendants of lost tribes of Israel. Some of them are communities that have converted to Judaism 100 years ago. So with each country that we visit, we plan to create an entire episode just on that community's story. And Nigeria is one of the biggest stories in all of Africa, based on how many people are practicing Judaism, how far along they are in their process of reconnecting.
No, I think you're breaking
a lot
up.
Of work in pre-production, the stories we were going to attend. We'll see if it gets better, but pause me if I break up.
We hear you now.
Okay, so the Nigeria trip was our pilot trip for the project. We've since been back already twice to Africa. We have another trip coming soon. But, this story is one of the biggest stories of the Jewish people in Africa. And we had done a lot of production ahead of time to plan this out and find all of the stories and even meeting the people that we were, planning to tell their story. We were meeting with them on Zoom beforehand. So there was a lot of production and preparation that went into this. And what I'll say before we get into getting arrested is that we did spend 2 days with a community in Nigeria. And it was amazing. It was so, so beautiful to see how we really connected with them so much in just 2 days, and we were even able to capture some amazing footage in that time as well. So I'll pass it to Rudy to continue on that piece.
For sure. So first of all, everything that Noam is saying is also what I experienced. It was a one of the most breathtaking experiences that we've ever both had. I do want to say that if we look at the situation where you have tribes of Israel located in the four corners of the earth and in some places where they're still suffering, if the situation was reversed and we were still suffering in Europe and North Africa and the Middle East, and they had managed to come home and create a civilization and revive a country with a military and an economy, wouldn't we expect them to come for us if we were being hunted and persecuted and suffering, or at the very least be connected so that we can all help each other? So the fact that this reality exists where our generation was born not even knowing that they are out there is something that I think is, you know, unfortunate and something that we have to correct as soon as possible. Like Noam said, we've already been to several other countries since. Nigeria, we went to Uganda, to Tanzania, to Zimbabwe, to South Africa, and soon we're going to another few countries that we can't yet talk about. We only talk about it when we come back. And so the goal of this documentary is to revive the stories, but like Noam said, they're all very different. Some of them are still practicing very Jewish customs that are noticeable, like kashrut and circumcision and all sorts of practices that you would notice. Some of them less so because they've unfortunately assimilated or been forced to stop practicing those things along the way. Some are coming back to their Judaism. Some have just come to Judaism. Each story is different. It's not one story. And so that's why it was important for us to create it as a series where each episode is going to focus on a different story. And yeah, when we got to Nigeria, we knew it was one of the more dangerous countries on our list, let alone in Africa, let alone in the world. We did do research. We spoke to security experts. We even had security with us with guns to protect us. There were certain places that we didn't go because we knew it would be too dangerous. We never posted our exact location. So it's not like we went there blind or knowing it wouldn't be a risk, but a lot of people after we got taken said, oh, you know, they're so immature to go into war zones and to risk their lives. And the thing I have to say to them is, I don't think you would say that to a Jew that grew up in America and left to fight the Nazis during the Holocaust. Sometimes you have to risk your life to go and do something greater than you. Now, we took the precautions necessary in order to minimize the risk. Of course, in hindsight, there's always more that could have been done. Maybe if we didn't post anything at all, there wouldn't have been information that gone viral that created conspiracy theories and lies about us, which forced things to happen. But moving forward, we learn from our mistakes and we continue moving. What's important is that we are able to reconnect our generation back to our brothers and sisters in that part of the world.
At the very end of what you said, you talked about how you ended up posting on social media and word got out and rumors got twisted. So you were only in Africa for one day before the photo of you presenting the Sefer Torah, 2 days before you presented the Sefer Torah to the, is it Igbo or Igbo?
Igbo, Jewish talent.
To the Igbo Jews. And then there were these rumors claiming that you were sent there on behalf of the State of Israel, and that you were there to, that Israel was declaring them a sovereign state. Can you guys tell us what happened after the word got out and then fill us in on the rest of the story?
So essentially, when we saw these posts, we thought this is pretty silly because it's a completely fabricated story about who we are, why we're there. There's a lot of made up parts. And, you know, we thought we need to post something to say that this is not the case. This is not who we are, but we weren't so concerned about it. What happened the morning after those posts were made is the police show up early in the morning, 7 a.m. at our hotel, and they tell us, hey, we just have some questions for you. We just want to clarify a few things. So if you can come down, bring your passports, bring your phones. And really, we went into this thinking, it's just a misunderstanding. We have to clear this up. It'll take maybe an hour or two and we'll be on our way. So, you know, we couldn't have imagined that the government would essentially believe the backstory. And even when they weren't able to find any evidence against us, they still continued to interrogate us and to hold us illegally without any proof that we had committed a crime or been in touch with anyone who the government of Nigeria considers to be a criminal.
Yeah, I mean, to continue off in the ridiculousness of the post, they were saying that the Sefer Torah itself that we brought was the weapon. They're like, these Mossad agents have brought this explosive device called the Sefer Torah to come and attack Nigeria. And, you know, when you hear this as a Jew, the sentence in itself, you can tell that it's ridiculous. Now, thankfully, we have hundreds of videos with hundreds, if not thousands of hours with millions of views of us doing work that shows who we are. We have a website with a pitch deck that talks about our project. We have a promo video that's been out for a year. We're going to several different countries. So in our minds, if people really wanted to know what's going on and who we are, they could easily find out. So when they came at around 7:30 in the morning on Friday morning on our third day there and called us to come down, we didn't think much of it. But unfortunately, when we came downstairs, it wasn't really the police. It was like 15 armed gun militants, many of them with black ski masks on, all with big guns, dressed out all in black. So this is not your standard police. This is like your militia militant group that is sent out to do all sorts of things that the government does to innocent people over there. But they did speak to us in a very calming way. Don't worry, it'll be an hour. We need to just take you for some questions. And we told them, listen, it's Friday. We need to film the preparations for Shabbat. We need to film tonight our welcoming ceremony before Shabbat starts. And then Shabbat, we have a Shabbat of all the youth Igbos of Nigeria coming and welcoming us. I'm like, don't worry. It's going to take just a few hours. They took us into this facility, this government facility. They were interrogating us for a bit, and we realized we're going to end up spending the night there. And then the next morning, they woke us up again with the same militant groups, took us into these vans, and from those vans drove us about 10 to 12 hours to Abuja, which is all the way in northern from where we were. And that's when we started our prison time in this like cage, which was a very rough experience. And we can go more into it if you'd like. But we made sure to always stay strong throughout the way. And it was amazing to have Yotam, who is not only the sitting or representing ambassador of Israel in Nigeria, and was working day in and day out to get us out and to help us in whatever way he can. But it was also a fellow Jew, a fellow Israeli, and a fellow AEPi brother. And that was actually one of the first things that he said to us. We saw him on the sixth day. So for 6 days, we didn't have food. We only had water. We're sitting in this disgusting cage, very small, didn't have the ability to shower. And we didn't even know if the world knew about us. We had no idea if people were talking, if people knew where we were. And so finally on the sixth day, when we met him towards the end of the day, the first thing he says is, Ani Israeli, Ani Ashagir Shel Israel. And I'm also an AEPi brother. I know your brother, like my personal brother, Dylan, who's also an AEPi brother. And so once he said that, it was immediately a sense of relief that, oh, the world knows where we are. And there are people who care for us. And this is a guy that we can trust. And he cares about us because of the background that we have and the shared experiences that we have. So that's kind of how it started for us. And it was very rough, but staying strong, keeping together, never losing our cool, never losing hope, never losing emunah and Hashem, that we were there all along for a mission. And this is just a test, is what allowed us to pass through three very rough weeks and eventually make it back home.
That's an incredible story and incredible with the connection of Yotam. Unfortunately, Yotam had a conflict and can't be on the program today. But I did want to ask you guys a follow-up about him. So we know that he's a brother from IDC Herzliya. After graduating, he began a career in Israel's foreign ministry. And he happened to be the acting ambassador of Israel to Nigeria, like you had mentioned. What is the role of Yotam play in your story? If you want to go more in depth and follow up from what Rudy said, that would be great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So after we were taken, arrested, it was 6 days before we had any contact with him or with the other ambassadors. And so the first contact, when Yotam was able to get inside of the security building, he had been trying for multiple days, but they prevented him from entering. And he walked in, or we walked into the office where he was sitting, and he had his little pin with the Israeli flag and the Nigerian flag. So we immediately felt a sense of calm, like, wow, this is one of our brothers here to help us in this situation. And to hear him speaking Hebrew, to hear how seriously he was taking the situation, was really relieving for us to at least know that somebody knew that we were there. And he also was working closely with the ambassadors from America and France. So, you know, together they had formed a team where they were strategizing, trying to figure every possible solution to get us out of the situation. And yeah, I can just say that I know Yotam really took this situation seriously and fought for us. And it was amazing to at least have him on our side in such a dark situation.
Yeah, unlike the other ambassadors, which also cared in their own way, it was different with Yotam. We can tell that this was like his family member in prison, not just the citizen that they care about as human beings. It was much closer. So he tried to bring us extra food if he could. There were even times, since we had no communications with our family, that I stole a book from one of the guards, and I ripped out the pages in the front and the back where they're blank, and I wrote letters on those pages. And when the first time that we saw Yotam after meeting him that first time, I snuck in and I put those letters in his suit pocket and told him that these are letters for my mom, take a picture and send it to her. And then later, when he came a few days later, because he was allowed to come every 3 or 4 days to make sure we were alive, they sat him far away from me, so I couldn't pass him the letters, and I had something very important. So I told him like that I'm gonna throw them on the floor and he needs to pick them up quickly as if he made something fall. So I threw the papers on the floor, and then he threw his notebook on the floor and picked up his notebook with the papers in a very slick way to not be noticed, and then put them in his pocket. And he would help us do things that any other ambassador would not risk their career, their lives, or whatever it is to be able to do. So you can tell that all along the way that, you know, this was family and he was going to do whatever it takes to get us out.
Wow.
Pretty spectacular. It's almost like, you guys should work on a screenplay as well, right? For your story.
After we were not lost.
But Alex and I were talking about this earlier today ahead of our session, that it's very, Israel's so unique in that as a country, it's not only interested in the safety of its citizens, wherever there are Jews in danger or in threat around the world, it will pop up, it will figure out how, if there's a way for it to play a role. And it's pretty amazing that it's, you know, it's a, like you said, it's family, right? But that's pretty spectacular.
Now, if you guys feel comfortable, I'd love to hear about the conditions that you were forced to be in for those 3 weeks and how you felt during those critical moments while you were in prison.
Yeah, I'll start there. There was one moment where things got very real as to how serious the government of Nigeria was taking this situation, which is that when we were dropped off at the security facility after this super long, hectic drive all the way across the country, they took us to a cell, like a dark, small, dirty cell. And we said, we're not going in here. You know, we haven't been arrested formally. You don't have anything against us. And we're not going in this cage. And we went back and forth for quite some time before they eventually brought backup guards and physically threw us into this cage. And when we get in there, we see that it's just disgusting. It's gross. We're in the dark. It's hot. There's bugs. There's no air conditioning. And we're looking at each other like, what is going on? How did we get into this situation? And we don't have any answers. No one has told us when we're going to be able to speak with anyone. You know, by this point, it's Saturday and the offices are closed. So there isn't even anyone formal around for us to have a conversation with. It's just the lower level guards treating us as if we're convicted felons. So it was definitely scary. And I was also feeling so much frustration because keep in mind, we had these two beautiful days with this Igbo community, and we're very inspired at what this project is going to do, the potential that it has to tell this story to a mass audience. And so I'm feeling like this is getting robbed from us, the opportunity to tell the story. We're supposed to be celebrating Shabbat right now, and instead we're locked in a cage without any communication with the outside world. So it became very overwhelming and frustrating. But, you know, like Rudy said, we knew that we were going to get through it. We were going to stay calm and figure out how to navigate out of this mess.
Yeah, so in addition, there were other things that we were very worried about. I think the first thing that we realized was that David, who's the third person with us, you know, this was a year ago. So me and Noam are, you know, Noam's going to be turning 28 soon. I'm already 28. But a year ago, we were both 27. And David was 47. And so he also has this immune system disorder that he needs medication every single day in order to survive. And if he goes 7 days without his medication, he dies. And he's already had two cancers from his condition. So he was in a very serious state when his medication was kept 12 hours away in our hotel. And we're in this worst possible scenario with the most bacteria infested rat, feces, human urine everywhere cage. And we're wondering, you know, if we don't get him out of here, get his medication in the next 7 days, he's not going to make it out. So thankfully, when Yotam first came, he was able to negotiate his release to the hospital. And then from there, the French embassy was able to take him and kept him in the French embassy the rest of the time. And Baruch Hashem, he survived and made it back with us. And from that moment on, after the first week, it was just me and Noam that continued the next 2 weeks following that. Just to give you some scenes, for us, whenever we'd be taken to the bathroom, which I can sure you can imagine how disgusting it is if that's how the room was where we were living, which, by the way, there was no beds or chairs. We were slept on the floor in that cage. They didn't have toilet paper. They'd give us a bucket that was there for everyone to use, who's been there for who knows how long and used by who knows how many people. And we'd have to fill up the bucket with water and cleanse ourselves with the bucket. And on the 7th day, they told us finally that we could take our first shower. And when we went to go and take a shower, they brought us to the bathrooms. And we're like, hold up, where's the shower? And they said, well, you're going to take the bucket and you're going to fill it up with water and you're going to dunk it on your heads. And so the only access to the shower we had was basically using this bucket in order to clean ourselves. After that first week, we only had 1 meal a day given to us by Chabad, unless we did things like, at one point we did like a little protest, and as a punishment, they didn't give us meals. There was even a time where they painted the room, the cage that we were in, with fresh paint, and they forced us to sleep in there with no wind blowing out the fumes. And, you know, we were coughing the whole time and holding our mouths, and they just didn't have any regard for human lives. There are many attempts that we tried to do to steal a phone in the beginning. We were trying to memorize all the different codes because they all had Androids. And so I was trying through a hole on the door, memorize the codes that they have and writing some of them into the wall so that when we would steal a phone, I'd have the code to the phone so I can access it. We managed to open one of the doors because it was a wooden door and a metal cage gate door. And I managed to open the wooden door when they would go to the bathroom. And I realized I can put my hand out and reach the table. And so we were thinking of different ways constantly of how to get out, because in our minds, we're not going to dine here. There's no way that our story is going to end. And that's all that we kept in mind. I would say around the 7th day, one of the guards, we started to build a good relationship with him in particular, and he was Christian while most of the guards were Muslim. And because I knew a lot of the arguments against this attempt for Christians to proselytize to Jews, whenever we would get into these sort of biblical debates, he realized that I knew more of the narrative that he was talking about than himself. And so he started to respect my position. And because of that respect, around the 7th day, he warns us, saying, listen, they're going to move you to another cage soon. And that other cage is going to be with 2 Boko Haram terrorists. And for those who don't know who or what Boko Haram is, it's a wing of ISIS. And he tells us that one of these guys killed 70 people in a terror attack, and the other guy, just got involved with the wrong people at the wrong time. So knowing that information, when we got into the next cage with those 2 terrorists, we were able to mentally prepare ourselves. And we even had sort of scissors in our pants ready in case something were to happen. And so the scenario for us there was constant fight for survival, constant maximize every chance of getting out or getting one word out or trying to get a phone or trying to memorize like the prison itself. When we found out there was a basement floor, that adds another calculation. We realized that there were power outages at certain times. Maybe we can do an escape when there's less power. There's people that are less there during the weekend. Maybe we can do that. There's one point where me and Noam stole a phone that was in a desk, but it was one of those Nokia phones. And so he was looking out in the room and I was in the bathroom trying to text someone. And we tried to do many things in order to maximize our escape there. Of course, many things didn't work, but a miracle that happened to us is that we both had our tefillin with us the whole entire time. For some reason, they didn't take it. They didn't even open it to check what was inside. We could have had a phone inside of it and they would have never known. And we put our tefillin every morning. And I remember around the 10th day, we were fed up. We had it. We've complied. We've given you our footage. We've answered every single question. And we're putting tefillin, and Noam reads the Shema Yisrael from the Chabad Shema Yisrael sheet that they give at the Kotel. And on the back of it, he reads, in the Talmud, it is written that in times of war, when you wear tefillin, you strike fear in the hearts of your enemy. And Noam looks at me, he's like, Rudy, are you down to put tefillin in the protest tomorrow? And I'm like, I'm about that life, let's do it. And so we both put our tefillin on and did a huge protest, which made a lot of noise in the prison. And, you know, we were like locking arms to make sure that they couldn't kick us out. A bunch of people were pulling each other back. And eventually they threw us back into the cage. And because of that, didn't give us food for the next 2 days. But because we did that, we made a lot of noise and certain people heard about our story, which we think eventually played moves. But there were so many signs to stay strong. Now, for the more believing brothers of our culture and Hashem and everything else, there was a pattern that we kept seeing. In the interrogation hallway, it was a long hallway because Nigeria is a country of 250 million people. And we would always be taken to one of the rooms at the end of that hallway. And it was always room 18. Now, for Jews, number 18 is the most, if not one of the most powerful numbers, which means Chai. The room right across our interrogation, which every room had another room across from it, where it was the guards in charge of that case, was room 26. Now, another very powerful number for the Jewish people, because 26 is Yud Kei Vav Kei, which means Hashem. Now, if I was asked before that moment, what are the two most powerful, meaningful numbers in Gematria for the Jewish people, I would say 18 and 26. But at that point, I'm not yet making the connection. And on one of the days, me and Omar are walking down, and I'm looking at the doorknobs, and I'm realizing every single door has Hebrew on it. And I look closer and I read Magen, which means shield or defense or protect. And apparently it's some Israeli door company that sold the doors to this Nigerian prison interrogation wing. But then we put two and two together. 26, Magen, 18. Hashem is protecting your life. And all along the way, there were constant signs, constant miracles that we were facing. And at no point did we lose hope. You know, me as a soldier, I have some of my friends who came out of that service with PTSD. And I always wondered, how come one friend doesn't have PTSD and the other friend has PTSD when we went through the same experience? And looking back and trying to understand how they perceived and dealt with the situation in the moment, I realized that those individuals were in shock, were afraid, didn't know how to process the moment in the very moment. So when they remember the moment, they feel trauma because those are the emotions that they remember. Where I know, at least for me, but I think Noam as well, when we look back at that moment, we look back at that moment with pride. We made it out. We stood strong. We stood up. We at no point allowed them to break us. We at no point gave up. And we were both there together. And when we got out, we didn't look back and say, oh my God, look what they did to us, 3 weeks of our life. Like, okay, they wasted already 3 weeks of our lives. We don't have more time to waste. There's other people that are still suffering there every single day because the experience that we have is just a drop in the ocean of experiences that Igbos faced in the past until this day. So one of the things that we promised the Igbo community when we got back to Israel and were able to speak to them is, look, we're not a part of the government, the institutions, the rabbinate to be able to make you any promises, so we will not. But we will make you this promise that we are the last generation that was born not knowing who you are. And it is our mission now to be able to tell their story in order for the world to realize who they are and to reconnect them back to our people.
Thank you both for sharing that story. And also thank you, Rudy, for answering my next question, which would have been what signs did you see and did you notice while you were in the prison that Hashem was there and watching over you, which you answered that beautifully. My next question is for both of you. Noam, I know that you participated in both AEPi Conclave and Convention when you were an undergrad. And Rudy, I know that you attended the Israel Engagement Summit in Las Vegas, which was generously sponsored by Brother Sheldon Adelson in blessed memory, and Dr. Miriam Adelson as well, along with Brother Mike Leven. And today's session is a part of our AEPi Connect Leven Leadership Series, which Brother Mike Leven is the generous sponsor of that and the Leven Leadership Institute. Mike Leven is also a lifelong philanthropist and the founder of the Jewish Future Pledge, which if you both are not aware of the Jewish Future Pledge, is a worldwide movement that is inspiring Jews of all backgrounds to commit that a portion of their estate that is given to charity, at least half of it is earmarked to charitable organizations and programs that support the Jewish people and or the state of Israel. So first off, both of you, if you haven't taken the pledge or if anyone that's listening hasn't taken the pledge, I will put the link in the chat for you guys to take the pledge. But my question for both of you that I want to ask is, what does ensuring the Jewish future mean to both of you? Noam, you can start off if you'd like.
Sure. So I would say that through my process of learning more about my own identity, you know, growing up in Reform Judaism in America, I didn't feel like I had a clear understanding of the mission statement of the Jewish people. And sometimes you hear people speak and it sounds like all they care is Jewish preservation. They just want to continue Jewish people, but it's not just for the sake of continuing. It's because the Jewish people have a mission to fulfill in this world, to be a light unto the nations. And I think that everyone has their own unique ability to contribute to that larger goal. So we have to realize that, you know, we're not only fighting anti-Semitism just to keep from drowning, but actually to go above and beyond it and do something, you know, even bigger that will ultimately affect the entire world. So, you know, I can say that moving to Israel has been a place where I've found a lot of spiritual growth, a lot more understanding and knowledge and history of the Jewish people. And it's become a huge passion for me. And I feel grateful that the work, the projects that we're doing can contribute to a goal that's much bigger than ourselves.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, we'd love for the Jewish Future Pledge to help also sponsor our project, if that's possible. But other than that, in terms of understanding the future of the Jewish people, we need to understand that we are the very few lucky ones that made it this far, and that the large portion of the Jewish people throughout history have been killed, burned, exiled, assimilated, forcibly converted. And so we are one of the few ones that have been able to make it this far and to keep their identity and to pass it down. We need to also recognize that so many people before us and generations before, because we're in a very, very ancient civilization, put in the work in order to move things forward. Now, the last chapter of Jewish history, we can call that Zionism. It was the attempt and success to revive and come back to Zion, which means Jerusalem. In 1948, we were able to establish our sovereignty on our homeland and to remove the British from their colonial rule. In 1967, we had wars that eventually allowed us to liberate Jerusalem and to make it our capital once more. And so there were different individuals and different chapters of Jewish history that have allowed our generation to be born in this current reality. But we need to start asking ourselves the question, what do we do now? We have the driver, the Jewish people. We have the vehicle, the land of Israel. But what's the destination? What's the path? Where are we going? What's the next chapter of Jewish history? What is our purpose to give? What is our mission statement? These are questions that we haven't been asking. You know, and I think that it's not just an individual's answer, so I can give you some of what I think, but I think it's a collective generational a sort of mindset that has to come to those conclusions and understandings, because there are many great minds out there for the Jewish people, and it's not just going to come from one or two people. Now, what I think I connect to in terms of the mission of the Jewish people, which has been what we've said culturally for thousands of years, has to do with something with Tikkun Olam and Ol HaGoyim. Tikkun Olam means to heal the world, and Ol HaGoyim means to be a light upon the nations, or in other words, to empower other peoples and collectives to freedom in order for them to achieve their own potential and their own greatness as a part of collection. And I think that that is something that has to be included within the mission statement of Israel. I think also structurally, we need to change the structures within Israel. Clearly the over bureaucracy that we have is frustrating everyone in the land, but also the system that we have. It's a British parliamentary system that exists within a Jewish state that the right doesn't like, the left doesn't like, the religious don't like, the secular don't like, the non-Israeli / Jewish don't like, and it's not a system that focuses on bringing the collective together and thinking long-term. It's a system that focuses on the short-term, because you can have a new election at any point, so politicians care about investing their efforts in short-term things that get a quick return in order to use that to get elected. And so we need to think about how do we create a system that allows whatever leadership that we have to think about things in long-term, in order for it to fulfill the needs of the whole collective we are, including the several ideological tribes that we've become from the left, the right, the religious and the secular, that all hold the piece of truth and light. But I think something that we've also realized going to Africa is that we can never be that full light until we include our other brothers and sisters in the four corners of the earth, because they also have elements of our culture and our people and our mentality and our identity and our strengths and our aspirations that have yet to come back. So we brought back the Ashkenazi piece of the puzzle. We've brought back the Sephardi piece of the puzzle. We've brought back the Mizrahi piece of the puzzle. We brought back a few others from the Bnei Menashe, the Ethiopian, and a few others. But there's so many other pieces to the puzzle that are still missing. And for anyone who's ever done a puzzle, you can't know where some of the pieces fit unless you have all the pieces on the table. So we've brought back some of the puzzle pieces, but they're sitting on top of each other. They're not working well together. And the only way to truly get there, in our opinion, is to reunite all these Jewish communities together and for us to have that conversation, not only where have we been and where are we now, but where do we need to go towards the future?
Now, following up on that, I'd like to ask you both, what can we in our own lives do to help with that mission and also to help advocate for the Jewish community?
Well, I think one big step that I took in the beginning of my journey was educating myself. You know, once I started to feel that maybe I don't know how to speak about Israel, I started learning the history. I wanted to learn all of the wars, how the conflict unfolded, not only the Israeli narrative, but also to understand the Palestinian narrative and those who speak ill of Israel from different angles. It's important to know, you know, the enemies, the arguments of our enemies. So the first step is definitely education, and it's an ongoing thing. It's something that I'm still doing to this day. And also just finding your individual natural talents and interests and pursuing them, becoming the best that you can be at them and finding a way to make a difference using that skill set that's unique to you. So for me, that came in the form of video production. I love filmmaking and I have been able to use my video production skills to put towards something that I feel is able to make a difference, able to reach a broad audience around the world and share narratives about the Jewish people in the state of Israel that maybe they're not so familiar with. So I think every person has to find that answer for themselves, but it starts with education and it starts with finding your own unique talents and skills.
I mean, to continue on to what Noam is saying, because I agree with everything he said, just to say it in my own way, I think everyone has a purpose to be a part of, whether it's a collective purpose or an individual purpose or both. And I think it has also to do with the problems that we feel or that we see. Everyone sees different problems. You can see some people more passionate about caring about the environment or about medicine or about animals or about humans or about technology or whatever it is. We clearly all have these triggers where we experience something in the world and there's something of what we're looking at and we notice a problem and we try to use our energy in order to correct that problem. And people see different problems. And I think the problems that we see through our eyes are a reflection of what our souls are trying to communicate to us that says, this is something that you were brought into this world in order to correct. So I think as long as you're in tune with the problems that you see and notice that these are things that you're supposed to go and solve and to fix and to heal, in tune with the passions that you have. So don't do something out in this world that you're not passionate about. In tune with the skills that you have and the skills that you can still learn, because there's skills in terms of nature that you're born with and nurture that you can skill. For example, public speaking is not something that I was born with. It's something that I've had to develop. Noam, as a filmmaker, it is passion that he has. He used his passion and combined that with something that he cared about for his collective people. So understand the problems that you see, understand the skills that you have and you can still acquire, and understand the passions that you have and try to do something combining that in order to make the world a better place. Keep in mind that this could be several things. It's not only one thing, and that whatever it is, it could also evolve with time. What worked for you today is not necessarily what worked for you 10 years ago or in 10 years. Your situation naturally evolves and you have to be in tune with that evolution.
Very well said from both of you. Now, we talked about both of your stories from when you traveled to Africa, as well as your AEPi story. So I have to ask, what is one thing that AEPi has taught you that you've carried on through your work in activism and leadership? Rudy, we can go with you first.
Sure. I mean, AEPi for me is not where I learned about my Jewish identity, because I was raised, thankfully, in an environment where I knew all about my Jewish identity. But I did see how many people didn't have that strong sense of Jewish identity or community. And because they came into AEPi, they had a place that fostered that care and that sense of identity for people who didn't have it. And I was also able to play a leadership role, whether starting as a pledge class president or getting involved in fighting as an activist, even before I went to Colombia and created my own group, which spread into a movement. You know, I was first fighting anti-Semitism with AEPi at UCLA. And so through what AEPi naturally does and has allowed people to do, I was able to enhance my skills, my abilities, my understanding, my awareness, and even understanding the impact that I could have through AEPi. So it's an amazing network. It's an amazing program. It's an amazing brotherhood. And we need to all cherish that and appreciate that. And I hope many more Jews will be able to join AEPi.
Thank you very much. And Noam?
Alex, can you repeat the question?
Yeah. What is one thing that AEPi has taught you that you've carried on through your work, either as a filmmaker or activism and leadership?
Mm-hmm. So one thing that's pretty cool is that I've been able to maintain relationships with AEPi brothers from all over the world. I did a semester in Australia when AEPi was first getting started in Australia. And when I went to convention, I met brothers from Canada, from the UK, and I've kept in touch with them through different chapters of my life. When I was living in New York City, some of my close friends were AEPis. Now, when they come to Israel, I host and am able to see them. So it is such a large network, and I feel like being able to cherish relationships, to have a strong foundation that we started from is an amazing place to be able to form friendships that do last a lifetime. So I'm grateful that I was involved in AEPi and still continue to be in different capacities.
That's wonderful. Now I have to ask one last question. We discussed a little bit about the We Were Never Lost documentary. As you guys are putting it together and as it gets released season by season, where can we find that?
So we can't yet publicly speak about it, but our plan and our goals, and we've already had deals from this place, is to put it on the largest network for people to be able to consume content and information. So our goal is really to get it on the place that the most amount of eyes will see it. We're not going to talk about anything before deals are signed, but that's always been our goal from day one.
Amazing. If there was something, I was trying to plug that in so that we can all watch that, because I know once it gets released, that's I'm really interested in seeing all the work that you guys have done.
In the meantime, again, people can follow us on social media at We Were Never Lost, whether on Instagram, Facebook. There's plenty of stories and highlights and content and snippets that we release there. And when it will be out, we will definitely post there. So if you'd like to follow up, it'll be there. And I'm sure maybe we can do an AEPi email to all of our brothers that are on the email list to check out the film. We can even do maybe a screening when it comes out for AEPi brothers. We'll talk about that down the line.
Amazing. Yeah, we'll definitely talk about that. Again, I want to thank you both for taking the time out of your day to share your story. And also, I want to thank you on behalf of everyone that's listening for all of your leadership and your activism on behalf of the Jewish people and the state of Israel. Also, I want to thank everyone in attendance, as these would not be made possible without your support. And thank you all for joining. Jay, is there anything you'd like to add?
No, it's really wonderful to have the two of you with us, sharing your story, amplifying the message. And we're so proud to have you as part of our AEPi family, but even more so as ambassadors for the Jewish people. Keep up the great work, and I look forward to seeing you very soon. And I know that there will be many, many years ahead we'll be able to celebrate successes and accomplishments, and look back on this and may this, you know, dark moment in your lives, be a blip on the map, and it may give you the strength to push you forward to continue to spread the word.
Amen.
Amen.
I will thank you, everyone. Take care,
thank
guys.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Chag Sameach.
Chag Sameach.